the science or lack of science behind the restrictions that we have today. We're going to cover this in a series of short videos. I'm going to try and hold it 15 minutes or less. Will Rogers was right. Okay, the problem isn't so much what people don't know. The problem is what people think they know that just ain't so. We're going to cover a couple of things this time, but we're going to go over everything. Hand sanitizers, face masks, social distancing, restrictions of outdoor activities. Are all of these based in science, control? Are they really protecting you? Let's get into it. First off, those restrictions are brought to you by the CDC, who has been in charge of the health of America for a long time. And what are we looking at the health of Americans? It's horrible. We have 54% of our kids have a chronic illness or injury. 60% of the adults have a chronic illness or injury. And all of these are not genetic. They're something that you have to earn based on the recommendations of the healthcare professional and our lifestyle. It's food, diet, nutrition. So first, how deadly is the virus? And it's interesting because I just heard a thing that, oh my gosh, this virus in this year has killed more people than the Vietnam War. Yeah, so does the flu virus every year. So did Vioxx, which was approved by the FDA, killed more people than the Vietnam War. So how deadly is the virus? You're going to find out. It's no more deadly than the flu. How is the virus identified? We're going to cover that at next talks. Who's at risk and who's not? Okay, does a virus affect everybody? It could. Okay, if they have a weakened immune system, it doesn't affect healthy people. Are the recommendations by authorities based in science? Are the authorities, think of this, are your authorities providing calm reassurance that your body is brilliant, that you're going to be recovering? Or are they spreading panic, flatten the curve? You know, we're looking at all of these bumper sticker slogans. Masked gloves, general population, social distancing, we're going to cover that. Biggest thing. So let's look at quarantine. Let's look at the quarantine in America and the quarantine in the United States. Okay, how's it affecting us? Well, roughly there's 39 million people in California, deaths annually. This means life. So is life more dangerous than the virus, or is the virus more dangerous than life? See, you don't save a life. You might extend it, absolutely. Okay, but people die. Okay, guaranteed. In fact, on average, 282,000 people every year in California die. And so far this year, 91,000 Californians have died. And this is what happens when you get old, sick, or have accidents. This is part of life. Normal daily deaths, we're talking 774 people in California die every day. So you have, just being in California, a 0.72% chance of dying. Read that backwards, you have a 99.3% chance of living. Okay, this will make sense in a second. Coronavirus deaths, as of April 28th, there were 1,793. So you have a 0.0045% chance of dying of the coronavirus. That means that you have a 99.996% chance of living. Now, just in the 39 days of lockdown, on average, life killed 25,000 people. And we're not panicking about it, but we are panicking about the 1,700. And so let's look at the U.S. The U.S., 118 days so far this year, since they found the first patient, okay? 330 million people, deaths annual, 2,800,000. These are, again, people die in America, 2,800,000 on average every day. That's around 7,700 each day. In America so far, coronavirus deaths, so just being alive in America, you have a 0.86 chance of dying. In America, if you're an American, you have a 99.14% chance of life. Coronavirus, USA, 54,000 deaths so far. So you have a 0.016% chance of dying of the coronavirus if you're an American, which means you have a 99.98% chance of living. Let's go to Johns Hopkins medical site. They have COVID infections versus flu. COVID worldwide cases around 3 million. Flu estimates about a billion. That's right, three times the amount of flu deaths as opposed to COVID deaths. when we look at the U.S., okay, deaths from COVID, let's just look at deaths. 206,000 deaths reported worldwide. In America, around 54,000. That's the COVID. What's the flu like? Between 290 and 646,000 deaths worldwide. So we're looking at about the same or three times more deaths from the flu. When we're looking at the deaths from the flu in the U.S., it's a bit more people die from the flu than die from the COVID. Now, the biggest thing, and this is where I want you to get this balance, they can say, well, the death rates are low because you're staying in place, you're staying home, we're shutting down the economy, we're collapsing the economy to save lives, to flatten the curve. Okay, is this appropriate? I don't know. Let's look at the World Health Organization. No one's ever done this. There's no scientific basis for isolating, quarantining healthy people. There is no scientific basis of shutting down the economy. Let's look at the World Health Organization. According to the New York Times, United Nations said hundreds of thousands of children will die this year because of the economic downturn. Or let's word it different. Hundreds of thousands of children are going to die this year because of the governmental response to this virus, which statistically looks no worse than the flu. If you have data that shows that it's not, because I've looked at the data for the last 4 months, and I'm telling you, some people are saying it's 10 times worse than the flu. It's 3 times worse than the flu. There's going to be 2 million deaths. There's going to be 20,000 deaths. So the estimates are not based in reality. Then we have barbarians like this, Garcetti, talking about tattle on your neighbors, shutting down. I mean, This is a fiefdom now. It's no longer Los Angeles. Historically, quarantine works, but you quarantine the sick or at-risk people. You don't quarantine healthy people. Nobody's ever done that. So let's look at the First Amendment. So I look at Cornell Law University, and it's interesting. Congress will make no law respecting the establishment of a religion, prohibiting free exercise thereof, abridging the freedom of speech or the freedom of press or the rights of people to peaceably assemble and to petition the government for a redress of grievances. It's interesting. You might say, well, that's a good idea. And sure enough, the redress of grievances was wiped out so we can't sue the vaccine manufacturers since 1986. And if any vaccine or medical intervention shows up for a pandemic, you can't sue them either because of the Patriot Act. Let's look at the free exercise clause. The Free Exercise Clause not only protects religious belief and expression, it also seems to allow for violations of laws that as long as the violation is made for religious reasons. So let's look at these laws, look at the lawmakers, because they work for us. Let's look at masks. Is this mask effective in preventing it, or is it not? Now, this is the World Health Organization, and this is, I didn't pick, cherry pick, from their recommendations. This is one paragraph. So first it says, community studies of influenza alike, that the use of a medical mask can prevent the spread of infectious droplets from an infected person to someone else and potentially contamination of the environment by these droplets. So potential. Let's look at this. There is limited evidence that wearing a medical mask by a healthy individual in households or among contacts of sick patients or among attendees of mass gatherings may be beneficial. So limited evidence that wearing a mask is beneficial. Let's read the next paragraph. However, there is currently no evidence that wearing a mask by healthy persons in the wider community setting, including universal community masking, can prevent them from infections of respiratory viruses, including COVID. No evidence, little evidence, and it can stop the droplets. Well, I don't know. Let's look at this one. How well do cloth-based coverings work to prevent the spread of COVID? There is limited evidence to suggest that the use of cloth coverings by the public during a pandemic can help reduce disease transmission. Let's look at Medscape. They had 4 people with positive COVID in a negative air pressure room, coughing in a Petri dish, putting in a mask, cough in another Petri dish, put a cotton mask, cough in a Petri dish, and they found out that they don't protect the spread of disease. What they did find is no virus on the inside, but a bunch on the outside. See, the whole thing with this face mask is to stop you from touching your face. if you have personal responsibility, because there are viruses all around us, okay? You should be able to touch your face, okay? Wash your hands, obviously. This is my mask, okay? Yeah, I built one, okay? So what is a virus? What is a virus? Do we need to be afraid of this virus and every other virus? Because now the world has changed. Let's go back to science. According to Fabio Romero, Institute of Human Virology, it's not a living organism, it's a well-organized molecular parasite. 45% of your genetic information is viral. We don't need to be afraid of viruses. When we look at this, viruses are vital for our ecosystem. They are able to move genetic information between hosts, but we still do not fully understand how this has influenced and continues to influence the evolution of our species. When we look at viruses and microorganisms, the presence of viruses do not mean that it causes the illness. If you find COVID on someone, did they die with COVID or did they die from a heart attack and still had COVID? So there's a lot of questions there. Coach postulates, this is where that you find a disease is a causative factor, that if you infect a healthy person with that disease, that they develop the disease. Theobald Smith developed the germ theory equation, which is brilliant. Virulence of pathogens. So how tough is this? Well, this has an RO factor, COVID, of around 2.4. That means you can infect 2.5 people. The number of pathogens, how big is your exposure? So that means you got to limit your exposure to walking, touching, doing everything. Or you strengthen your immune system. Opening size, that means how much is coming into your system by the resistance of host. That's the severity of the disease. The Lancet, the germ theory has become dogma, but it neglects the fact, many other factors that have played a part in deciding whether this host germ environment complex will lead to infection. British Medical Journal, the biomedical model of illness has dominated healthcare for the past century, cannot fully explain many forms of illnesses. This is the key. Is it the virus that's causing it? Do you have to be afraid of touching everything or being close to a neighbor or anything else? No, that doesn't make sense. Look at your species. Your species is a communal being. We're touching, we're hugging. We're designed to live in this environment full of viruses and bacteria and funguses and parasites. The biomedical model of illness, which has dominated healthcare. Think of this. Does all illness have a single underlying cause? Is it just this one virus? Look at the people that are dying. It's comorbidities. They have 99.9% of everybody that dies from this, and any other flu has comorbidities. It doesn't attack healthy tissue. Disease is always from a single cause. Is that a theory, a fact, or are there underlying causes? Removal or attenuation of this disease will result in return to health. What does the British Medical Journal say? Evidence exists that all these assumptions are wrong. The biomedical model of illness has become dogma. It's time to change this dogmatic approach to health and realize that you are beings in charge of your life and you're designed to live here. Okay, look at the real science, and also you can start to look at why they're controlling your actions. But take charge of your life. You are built by God. You are sentient beings. You are designed to live here. The world has not changed. Just the controlling factions that we have put in power are controlling you. This is Dr. John Bergman. God bless you. I love you.